Hi, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Economic Ideas Forum. It's the seventh edition of this event, which brings together speakers from the private sector all over the world, political parties across Europe, and lots of great thinkers from right here inside the Brussels bubble. They're going to discuss policies that will hopefully improve life tomorrow. If you've had a peek at the Wilfred Martens Centre YouTube channel, you will see that these guys are ideas ninjas. And that's the spirit that I want us to have today. Ideas ninjas, get involved. Here in the room, please ask lots of questions. Don't be shy. If you're watching on the live stream at home, tweet away and we'll pass your questions on to the panelists and generally have a great conversation going there as well. And above all, get out of that mindset of a traditional panel discussion. We're going to be limiting the speakers to 3 minutes each, so we'll have lots of interesting ideas going on. To tell you a bit more about today's event, I'd like to call on Tomi Huhtanen, who's the Executive Director of the Martens Centre. Sir.
Thank you. Good morning, and welcome to the Economic Ideas Forum of 2016. 1 year has passed very, very quickly. We started our trip to organizing these forums 6 years ago in Madrid. Then we had a meeting in London, Dublin, Helsinki, Bratislava, and now second time in Brussels. And we would like to welcome you all, and I'm especially happy to see many faces who have been in the previous meetings loyally, but especially we would like to thank our business partners, AT&T, Walt Disney Corporation, Bayern, Microsoft, Google, and UPS for supporting this event, which has happened already now a seventh time. As you remember, a year ago when we finished the Economic Ideas Forum, one of our conclusions, kind of takeaways, was that was really the first meeting for a long time when we didn't speak about economic crisis, financial crisis. And I guess the expectation was by then that we would have this smooth sailing also in year 2016. But as we know, 2016 was not very gentle with us. We didn't have very dramatic economic events, but we had various other type of challenges. We had the terrorist attacks in Europe, also here in Brussels. We had UK referendum with the surprising result. We had US election, even more surprising support result. And well, some days ago we had the Italian referendum, and still we have some weeks to go before end of the year. So, of course, the temptation would be maybe to focus on this dramatic event and speak about the economic challenges they will cause. But our view and our message is that, in fact, we think that something much more dramatic and even revolutionary is happening in economics, in global economics, changing it. So our view, what we want to focus on is the long-term perspective. We want to focus on future. We want to focus on tomorrow. So in our first discussion, we will focus on the future of work, how we will work in the future. Because of the internet, because of the mobile applications and various other aspects of digital economy, the work is changing. Some take that as a challenge, some take that as an opportunity, and we'll discuss about that. In our second discussion, we will see how to connect people and this new world of work through education, but still trying to maintain very high creativity. In our third discussion, we'll speak about digital economy as such, digital single market, but having the view of investment, how to get the investment in play in order to make sure that the European economy will remain competitive in the future, in the global scene. And we're going to, in the fourth discussion, we are going to stick with the word competitiveness and speak about industries. As we know, a lot of production has left Europe, but we are going to discuss what is our new setting and new possibilities with these developments, especially focus on industries, and we are going to speak about the aspect or the concept of industry 4.0. And then last, but definitely not least, we are going to speak about the growth. The narrative is that we are now entering to the low growth era, and we are going to discuss about it, whether it's true or not, and what are the implications. And there in between, we are going to have a very interesting and intensive session on UK, well, Brexit and different scenarios for that. So that's the setting for the day. Once again, welcome, and we are very much looking forward to have a very fruitful debate with you. And with no further introduction, it's my great pleasure to give floor to our president, President Mikuláš Dzurinda, president of the Martens Center and former Prime Minister of Slovakia. Mr. Dzurinda.
This podium is devoted to young future leaders, and this one is devoted to older leaders from the past. So this is my brief explanation why I'm changing the position. Ladies and gentlemen, dear guests, it is my real pleasure to welcome you all to the 7th edition of the Economic Ideas Forum on behalf of the Wilfried Martens Center for the European Studies. It has already become a tradition that we are meeting towards the calendar year in order to evaluate and to reflect the year, which is coming slowly but surely to the end. In time, when we take stock of how the last year has been for us, and that it has been an eventful year, cannot be questioned. A number of questions are being raised about the future of the European Union, about our European community, especially after the Brits have decided to leave the European Union. No matter how difficult may be the talks on a new partnership with the United Kingdom, we should always remember that there are many more unifying terms between the continental Europe and the UK than the divisive ones. We should not forget that when we pulled the same rope in the past, we succeeded even overcoming more difficult challenges than Brexit. Together with the UK, we overcame such huge challenges in the past like fascism or communism. We were caught off guard also by the conduct and outcome of the US election, as Tomi has already mentioned. The feeling that at any time Europe could turn to and rely on a strong transatlantic alliance has weakened. But the alliance with the United States should remain our primordial, our strategic interest. The new reality should encourage us to take even greater responsibility for tackling problems of security, especially in our neighborhood. Also this year, we are looking for an answer to the question on how to avoid, let me say, new immigration tsunamis, on how to strike the right balance between humanism and solidarity on one hand, and our real possibilities and security on the other. Moreover, the impact of the financial and economic crisis has not yet been fully dealt with. We may note with satisfaction that the measures taken to safeguard the euro area proved to be correct. The developments in Greece, but not only in Greece, also in some other countries, demonstrate that the real remedy for at-risk countries consists only in the reforms. Step by step, we are working on the corrections to our European House. However, corrections are not enough. We should go beyond mere corrections and strengthen the building and the development of our reunited Europe. We must do it in a manner that will make all of us living in our common house better understand one another, that will make all of us feel good in our house. We need a clear as well as attractive vision of our continued living together. Only in this way will we be able to find the right answers to our rapidly globalizing and rapidly changing world. Only in this way will we be able to meet the challenges of the fourth industrial revolution. I don't believe this is the time to build protective walls around our countries or to close ourselves to the world. But even if we want it, it is not possible to build a wall high enough to protect us from the expanding international trade. It is impossible. It is also not possible to adopt a law that would stop massive technological advances. It is not possible to prevent the results of technological advances make their way into our countries. What is possible and also necessary is to get very well prepared for such development. To consider globalization and technological advances as an opportunity and not as a threat or as a disaster. What I consider to be a common, cross-cutting, but also universal tool to come to terms with the present day and the future challenges is education. This is the area on which we should concentrate our efforts. Educated young people with firm ethical and moral values, well-educated and highly principled, are the only hope for the future. Education is no longer needed just to enable young people to find a job. Education is becoming a perpetual, a permanent need for all of us. I am glad that the reform of our education systems, designed to make them meet the needs of a changing world, will be an important topic on the agenda of today's conference. Concluding, dear friends, I would like, as usually, to thank our sponsors, AT&T, CCIA, Disney, Google, Uber, and UPS, for their support, for their confidence in this event, which in my view can be, and I am pretty sure, will be highly inspiring. I also want to thank all panelists, all moderators, but also to all organizers for their inputs, for their good work, and last but not least, I would like to thank you all for coming, for joining, for your active participation. I wish you all very productive, but also inspiring event. Thank you very much.
Take your seats. Great. Mikuláš, thank you so much for that. Lots to think about today. So here we go, panel one, tomorrow, how will we work? Before we start on the speeches, I'm going to talk you through the rules of the game because they're a little bit different for normally. First of all, our first speaker will make a 6-minute, not 1 second more, intervention from up here at the lectern to give us all plenty of ideas to discuss. And then each of our speakers will have 3 minutes, again, no more of opening remarks. How can we be so sure about the timing? Because these panels will start flashing when you get to 30 seconds before. And we might even do that to you too. Now, there's only one way to find out whether we'll actually use the noise, but I suggest that you stick to your time instead. We have a live stream at home, so everybody can watch on Facebook Live. Say hello to the viewers out there in the world. We have a Twitter hashtag, it's EIF16. So when people say stimulating things, don't keep them to yourselves, share them with the world, get tweeting. And over here, we have Rafa Zanudo, who's our live cartoonist. And he's drawing away, he's gonna riff on various things that people are saying and come up with a little visual keepsake of the day as well. So let's get cracking. This first panel consists of Anne Mettler, who's head of the European Political Strategy Centre, Henna Virkkunen, MEP, who's on the ITRE committee. We've got Brhmie Balaram, who's senior researcher at the Royal Society for the Encouragement of Arts, Manufacture and Commerce, beautiful name, 260 years old from the UK. Here is Matthias Schäfer, who's head of financial and labour market policy at the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung in Berlin. And Marco Torregrossa, who's managing director of Euro Freelancers and the secretary general of the European Forum of Independent Freelancers. Perfect. Without further ado, Anne, please kick us off.
Thank you so much. I guess the fact that I'm going up here means I'm also quite passé, but a great pleasure to be with you this morning. Now, before I start speaking, I have to give the usual disclaimer. Nothing that I say here today represents an official position of the European Commission. I run the internal think tank. I have a mandate to think a little bit out of the box, so attribute nothing that I say here today directly with the European Commission. But with that, let me dive right into the theme, which is, of course, the future of work. Let me say up front that the vast majority of people in Europe continue to be employed in full-time permanent positions. Also, in most of our countries, the employment rates have never been as high as they currently are. So this just as the backdrop. But let me speak a little bit about what I see as some underlying trends. So first of all, it was already mentioned this morning, digital technologies, I believe, are really remaking the very architecture of the corporation. So from a vertically integrated corporation to a much more networked, agile, and fast-moving business model. As a result, we can organize work now in completely different ways, with even core functions such as human resources or accounting easily outsourced even including to other countries. And also, work on demand obviously is on the rise, as is the organization of work in projects. This is often referred to, and you may know, as the Hollywood model. So let's see if my... Does it work? No. This was it, exactly, the Hollywood model, where people with different skill sets come together to work on a project. So if you think, for instance, of how Hollywood does this when they produce a film, people with different skill sets come together, not to permanently work together, but essentially to deliver on a film, and then everyone goes their separate ways. I think that we're going to be seeing this also elsewhere in the economy, and it will have profound ramifications. Already today in multinational corporations, people work on projects across continents. So you have teams that work across the globe. And I also think one of the ramifications will be that in the future, you oftentimes no longer actually have to live where you work. So profound ramifications. In addition, we need to reconsider what is a job. Is a job only a permanent contract and working full time? Or can a job be assembling a number of paid tasks and working as a freelancer? So if you have a property that you would rent on Airbnb, or maybe you drive Uber for 15 hours a week, is that a job? I think we need to have these discussions because I see a world coming where there will be plenty of work, but perhaps fewer jobs. At least the way we have traditionally conceived of them. And plenty of people, and I think we need to be very clear about this, plenty of people want to work this way and enjoy independent work more than being employed. I came across this chart the other day from McKinsey, study on self-employment, and you see that the satisfaction with independent work ranks higher in several categories. So this is not just about independence or so, it's also about creativity, it's about opportunities. However, we see that the satisfaction ranks a little bit lower for those who do it by necessity in two categories. You see it here, income security and income level. So I think this is something that we need to pay attention to. But overall, it's important to understand that independent work for many people is a choice that they make over what we would consider traditional employment. And thirdly, a flexible skill set will be more important than ever before. Future workers will likely not only have several jobs in their lifetime, but several careers. And a lot of the skills that today are really the hottest, as you will see here, this chart was provided to us by LinkedIn. A lot of these skills didn't even exist 10 years ago. So you see here, number one, cloud and distributed computing. A statistical analysis and data mining. So from a public policy perspective, it's extremely difficult to prepare people for jobs and skills that don't yet even exist. So this is really a formidable challenge, and that's why we need, as I said before, the flexibility, people to adjust and to pay attention where the skill needs go. In addition, we have, of course, the risk of automation. I sit on an expert group at the OECD, and several of my peers are of the opinion that anything that can be automated will be automated in the future. But that's why it's so important that we focus on skills that cannot be easily automated. So I'm showing you this slide here, where you see very clearly that the skills that are most in demand is the non-routine interpersonal skills. But you also see a massive decline in routine manual skills. So what this tells us essentially is there is a sort of a bifurcation in the labor markets where people with top skills really are very much in demand, and people that have these manual and routine skills in massive decline. So it is something that we need to pay close attention to. So there's, of course, also a lot of anxiety about massive job losses. The economist Paul Krugman once said that if you had told a farmer in the 1830s that 150 years later only about 5% of the population would be working on the land, he would have been very scared and shuddered at this prospect. The reality is that every transition brings with it job losses, but also job gains. So I want to stress, I don't want to be overly pessimistic here. And in general, I think the more we fight change, the faster the job losses will come. But it is also important to really pay attention to job creation. As you see here, that it is particularly young companies, these are the top here, the pink ones and the blue ones, young companies that are creating jobs. Older companies are, on balance, net destroyers of jobs. And that's important to keep in mind when we speak about the future of work, because the future of work will depend, of course, on these jobs being created in the first place. And that's why we need these young companies. So we need to pay attention to entrepreneurship and to scaling up young companies. Now, as I only have 6 minutes, I was going to draw three very quick, perhaps initial conclusions that I would draw. The future of work will present more transitions. I think that's very clear. Be they the pursuit of several careers, or be it that maybe in mid-career here, you need to go back to reskill. So we'll have more transitions. So social policy needs to adjust to these new realities and accompany people during these times of transitions in their working lives. Secondly, given that there will be more transitions, one really wonders a little bit about the benefit of having our social protection so closely tied to our jobs. Perhaps we need to rethink that and give the social protections directly to the individual rather than linking it to a permanent job. Thirdly, there's a lot of talk about the gig economy and the rise of freelancers, but what you may not know is that in terms of social benefits, they are often very different for freelancers and those with a permanent contract. And I had to learn that myself when I had children here in Belgium. So when you're self-employed, I used to be self-employed, you have as maternity leave a minimum of 3 weeks and a maximum of 8 weeks. But if you have a permanent job, you have 16 weeks. You know, that's who comes up with these kind of rules. And I think it is really a deterrent to many women to pursue self-employment here in Belgium. I think subsequently it's been changed, but when I had my children, that's how it was. So I think we need to look at the benefits for freelancers and for the permanently employed. So in sum, there are a lot of changes underway in the world of work. They will happen whether we embrace them or not. So I think that former Prime Minister Dzurinda was absolutely correct on that. So I see a lot of benefits in being really very proactive and trying hard to anticipate and to really accept this new world of work and to be active participants in this and not just sort of to step back and see what happens to us. Thank you so much.
Brilliant, Anne, thank you so much. Lots to think about there. A really great start for our discussion. So you say who makes these rules? The answer is policymakers. So next, let's come to Henna from the European Parliament. Henna, what should the policy response be at an EU level to these new, more flexible employment models? Should you as legislators even be encouraging it?
Yeah, thank you, Anne, for your inspiring opening words. First of all, I think the most important issue still is that everybody has the chance to work. And if we are looking at the rates, now we can be happy about it, that the unemployment rate in the Eurozone was 9.8% now in October. So it means that it was the lowest rate since July 2009, so lowest rate since 7 years nearly. So that was good news. But what's worrying, I think it's the youth in unemployment and mostly in the Southern Europe. We know that in Spain, Greece, Croatia, and Italy, the rates are far over 40% of young people's unemployment. And I think it's very worrying because that's maybe one of the most important things in Europe we should do now when we are fighting against populism and radicalization, that we should give future for our young people. And when we have so much people, young people who don't have a job, who don't have anything to do, I think it's very worrying for whole Europe's future. And in the same time, anyway, we know that the European companies, they are reporting that they can't find people with right skills to contract. Already now, 40% of European companies, they are reporting that they have difficulties to find right kind of employers. So it means that we really have to focus now to educational system in different member states and think that how we should reform whole educational system that we can meet the skills and we can get the skills for young people and also for those people who are already in the workforce. Because now I think today we are going to speak a lot about digitalization, which is the mega trend of the world. And now 9% of our workforce in Europe haven't never used internet. So it's a big gap we have, because if we are thinking about what kind of demands we have and then what is now our basic level, so we have much to do.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Didn't even get to the planning bit. Brilliant. Thank you. Sorry.
I think that's good for opening.
That's wonderful.
If
brilliant.
I want to give turn to the others, then I think we can discuss more.
Brilliant. Guys, you're going to have more coffee in the break. You need to keep encouraging everybody. Brhmie, you, I think, maybe come from the US. You can perhaps share a new perspective. When we talk about the future of gig economy in Europe, maybe we should be learning lessons from there, particularly with regard to innovations outside of the legal system, things like portable benefits and stuff that could be a handy solution.
Thanks, Frances. So I'm actually Canadian, but I do think that there is a lot that we can learn from the US. So the first thing that I wanted to say was, I think that in the UK and in Europe, we tend to have a tendency to lean on hard levers, like the legal and political system, to enact change. And so we've seen that most recently in the UK with the employment tribunal that Uber drivers initiated. So in this employment tribunal, it was ruled that these drivers should actually be classed as workers rather than as self-employed, which is what Uber has been identifying them as so far. And I think that what we need to recognize about businesses like Uber is that they are such flexible business models that they can continue to innovate and change their business models and adapt it in ways in which they, in future, they'll still be able to identify these workers or these drivers as self-employed. And so I think that we need to be looking at social innovation as a way to better protect and support these workers. And so in the US, we've seen the rollout of portable benefit platforms, which mean that workers can take their benefits with them, whether that's healthcare or pensions contributions, as they move from platform to platform. So you can start off by working for Uber, but then maybe move on to a delivery platform like Deliveroo or a cleaning platform like Hassel, and you'll still take your benefits with you. And I think that's a really interesting innovation that we need to explore more in Europe. But there have been some really interesting partnerships that have emerged as well. So we've seen a completely different approach by trade unions in the US. So the International Machinists Association is a big trade union in the US. And there's the Freelancers Union, which is another association. It's a professional body that represents freelancers. And they've both partnered with Uber in New York to come up with new sorts of ways to protect workers. And so the Freelancers Union is looking at developing a portable benefits platform in New York, but the International Machinists Association is actually looking at how do you better protect workers. And so one of the things that they've come up with is instituting an independent panel, which will allow workers or drivers to challenge unfair dismissal. And that's something that you can't actually get even through the legal classification of worker, for example. So I think that's one of the reasons why we should be looking at some of these social innovations to supplement any sort of legal action and political action that we take. And we've also seen Handy most recently this week table a new proposal where they want to require all platforms to contribute 2.5% of every transaction to the workers so that they can purchase their own health insurance in the US. So, I mean, we're going to have to think about how we adapt some of those models here because obviously healthcare isn't as big of an issue here as it is in the US. But I think that it completely stands for things like covering sick pay or maternity pay, et cetera. So as Anne was saying earlier, I think that we need to be able to offer self-employed people better benefits and better protections.
Perfect. And you made it just when the panels were flashing as well. Very impressed with that. So, Matthias, this sounds like a really rosy picture, portable benefits, people doing 15 hours a week for Uber. How can we guard against the gig economy becoming synonymous with precarious employment? Does this sound possibly to you even like exploitation? And what should we do with social security? Your thoughts?
Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot. Well, actually, I do think as well that I share what Anne said, that there are huge benefits behind this trend. Nevertheless, as you came as well with this policy maker's point of view, I think that we have to bear into mind that actually the trend we are going on means that there will be more insecurity, more flexibility, and this counters actually the needs and the wishes of our people, because they would like to get back control. But actually what we outline for them is the way to profit and to benefit from these overall trends will lead you through a period of insecurity where we have to, in a way, not only adjust our education and security systems, but at least are prepared to leave things behind us that were quite in common for our European value system as well. And this is something where I would underline that we have to be more precise and clear in what is the benefit, not only for the ones that can profit, that have these jobs you outlined with data engineering and all these things, but as well for ordinary people that do not hold this pace which is behind these trends. And there I think we did not the best job in the last decade, as well driven by all these crises. And from my point of view, this is the highly interesting political issue to debate, to get some give some reflections of what could it mean. For example, our social security systems, for instance, are highly focused on pensions, for instance, or on healthcare, or not in Germany, this is not the case, on unemployment insurance. But I think that we have to be open-minded to take and to shift budgets which are nowadays in these pension systems and lead them towards the education system. That means bring more money into the education system, but tell people as well that this will probably mean that we don't have as much money, public money, for the pension system, meaning you have to work, for example, longer, but you don't work at the end of your, when you start retirement age, you don't go from 100% to 0%, but you go in a ladder downstairs to you work 4 days, 3 days, 2 days, and via this raise the retirement age, for example. So I think that we have to take this into consideration when we speak about new social policies that frame the situation that there is a trend, a global trend, of overall more instability and insecurity.
Great. And so in your worldview, it's this thing that control comes from knowing that you have a job. I suspect Marco feels just the other way, that control comes from being a freelancer and super flexible. So should these be promoted as new ways of stimulating employment and giving people control over their working lives?
Well, I think first it's important to clarify what freelancing is and what it differs and how it differs from self-employment, because the two terms cannot be really used interchangeably. Now, freelancers or independent professionals are highly skilled, well-educated, self-employed workers without employees nor employers. They offer specialized services of a knowledge-based nature, and they work on a flexible basis in a range of creative, managerial, scientific, and technical occupations, primarily in business-to-business. Now, these people are actually the smallest of small business in Europe, and according to Eurostat, with a 45% increase since 2004, are actually the fastest growing segment of the European labor market. So freelancers are the higher end spectrum of self-employed, and the vast majority of them consider themselves and operate as a self-contained small business rather than a worker. So that misclassification discourse is actually irrelevant for them. So why I'm telling you this is because the recent coverage, media coverage of the gig economy has created the perception that all independent workers are driving for Uber or running household errands through TaskRabbit. But this is actually a very small subset of independent work, which spans a wide range of skills level and income brackets. Now, while independent work is prevalent in the construction, in cleaning industry, in transportation, is actually very, very widespread in knowledge-intensive occupations. Writers, designers, lawyers, accountants. It's very common for a university professor these days to supplement his income by writing textbooks or consulting, which are activities that qualify as independent work. A good friend of mine, she's a therapist, and she actually finds more and more work online. And I ask her how, and she says, well, there's actually an online platform that connects psychotherapists with people that need psychotherapy. I mean, I kid you not. I mean, these things exist, and she has a PhD. So we need to change a little bit our perspectives here. And the second part of your question was about creating employment. It's good that you said employment and not jobs, because what we're trying to tell the policymakers is that they really need new metrics to measure the strength of the economy, not just by the number of jobs created, but by the number of hours worked. Now, the policymakers need better statistics and better to analyze better the independent workforce, by using updated labor market surveys with the right criteria and updated updated categories. For example, one of the biggest gaps is that the labor market surveys do not ask respondents what is your primary source of income, and they ignore what is the people that supplement their income on the side. And the second gap, and I conclude with that, is that labor market surveys are actually failing to capture whether self-employment is done by choice or by necessity, which is a significant piece of knowledge to understand whether a worker is pushed or pulled into independence.
Great, brilliant. So lots to think about there. We've had our first cartoon pop up as well. Very nice. It looks like me going to Pilates in the middle of the day, which I can do because I'm freelance now. It's been 2 years and it's been very good fun. So I guess this comes to the crux of the matter, right? That you have two really quite different populations who come under this umbrella of freelance self-employed. And again, as Anne pointed out, that actually is still a very small proportion of people generally compared to people with a classic 9-to-5 proper job. How do we... Is there a way to kind of draw a line between the two? This question of, like, is it your primary source of income? How many hours a day do you spend doing each thing? One of the joys of the internet is it's so much easier to measure stuff, so we could actually collect meaningful data on that. And you want to come back on some of these points?
Yeah, I think there is a big distinction to be made by those who choose this kind of work. And I think I would argue it's an increasing number. And those who really have to, because there is a big difference. And of those that have to, I think, as we said before, there is, I mean, as you rightly pointed out, Matthias, there is a higher degree of uncertainty. But I think rather than trying to shut down these jobs, because this is where the trend is going, we need to look at tools that help people in times of transition. So, for instance, if you're driving Uber and you break your leg, you know, I mean, what happens? If you don't work, then you don't get paid. So maybe we need to think of schemes that help people during times when they cannot be active. By the way, we do this for actors. Actors don't work usually year-round, and there are schemes to help people in times when they cannot work or don't find work. The point that I'm making is we are better off by embracing these are underlying trends. A lot of millennials don't work. They don't want to work 9-to-5 jobs and regular jobs. I mean, this we have to accept that. I mean, you cannot do away with this by public policy. So starting by asking people, are you doing this voluntarily or do you feel like you have to, would strike me as a good start, and then devise policy solutions for people that feel this vulnerability, because I think there is something that needs to be done. I agree with that.
Perfect.
Yeah, I think that the young people today, they don't expect that they are going to have that kind of working career, that they are going to have a job and then they are going to be in the same work next 40 years. I think the expectations are also different, that the people, they know that they have to re-educate and chase their jobs during their working life, and I think everyone starts to be prepared for that. But I would like to underline the role of basic skills again, because then if you don't have basic skills, maybe you don't have really a choice. Yeah. So, and I'm very worried about it. If we are looking at our teenagers, nearly 20% of them, they have poor reading and writing skills in Europe, and more than 20% have problems in mathematics. So I think that kind of basic skills, everybody have to have and get from their basic education, because it's basis for all the learning after that. So I would like to underline very much the role of basic education in all our member states.
Perfect. And I guess as a Finn, you know, with your PISA scores, you can be the you can be the ambassadors for that in some way.
Yeah, no, of course our PISA scores are not so good anymore also, because we haven't, you know, we should have made reforms also in our educational system, because it has been a little bit the case in Finland that we have had so good PISA results that nobody haven't touched the educational system. And of course, it needs to be also updated, because the world is changing all the time and people, they need new kind of skills. For example, World Economic Forum has been listing what kind of skills are needed in 2020. And if I take five most important skills, they are not reading and writing, but they are like, number one, complex problem solving. Two, critical thinking. Three, creativity. 4, people management, 5, coordinating with others, and emotional intelligence. So that kind of skills that you can't really learn if you are reading books. It means that you have to really think what kind of teaching methods you are having at schools and how you can give that kind of skills for young people, like complex problem solving or critical thinking and creativity.
Yeah, there we are. And I guess it's an object lesson about the dangers of complacency as well, which is something that shifts in this new economy where you have to be constantly looking at your phone going, what's my next job? What am I going to do today? Where am I going with this? Which can obviously be quite worrying. Should we talk about inclusivity? Because one of the big arguments in favor of flexible working is it's easier for women to get people into the workforce, to get these diverse groups in there. Would you say that's a plus point? Matthias?
Sure it is. I mean, actually, this trend will reduce barriers to find jobs, but when we reduce barriers, this is what we know from globalization, that will mean as well that there is the other way around. And we have to cope, we have to decide whether we will just like this or not. So, I mean, everything that opens new opportunities will as well give more, as I said, insecurity. Perhaps one thing to underline is I think that we are not so well, that it's not the right perspective only to reflect on self-employment. It's more about, you said, that the core employment will stay what we knew. What does it mean, this overall trend of robotics or artificial intelligence, which is, from my point of view, the main driving force behind Industry 4.0, what does it mean to our stable and used workforce we know? There are reports from the think tank of the Federal Agency of Employment in Germany saying that, figure out, 90% of the operations, a chemical worker, which is a high-earning job, for instance, in Germany, for example, at BASF or Bayer, can be replaced by robots. 90%. And when it is right that everything that can be made by robotics will be, then this means that we will hit directly into the core of our known workforce. Not self-employment, but people that are employed. So I think that self-employed people already have, in a way, an advantage to what is coming up in the next decades on trends for our overall labor markets. Airbnb, now forbidden in Berlin, but they pushed new spirits into the hotelery about how to design the offers they bring to their clients. Uber brought in some new ideas in the taxi business as well in Berlin to open up applications on the smartphones for their clients. So, I mean, we have the chance to profit from this competitive approach as well for the hardcore, I call it like this, workforce, and not only on the self-employment scheme. And I think we should more pay attention and concern about what is happening there as well.
Yeah, that's a lot of good points. I mean, a lot of people are panicking about Uber now, but when it comes to self-driving cars, will we even be worrying about the people? Marco?
Well, I think we should. We need to move past a very narrow debate between employees versus self-employed, or discussions like, is Uber evil, or is the sharing economy exploitative, et cetera, et cetera. I think what is the right question we should be asking ourselves is, what enabling environment do we need for workers to find multiple and better alternatives than a traditional employment? We should not lament that Uber drivers don't get benefits and security. We should ask ourselves why benefits comes attached only with a full-time job. And this challenge is much bigger than asking Uber to reclassify their drivers as employees. It involves dramatically reformulating our safety net and the way we classify companies and workers. It will mean finding ways to fund the portable benefits or new insurance schemes that could protect against episodic income. It may mean allowing workers to bargain, to collectively bargain with a platform such as Uber or Etsy, or it may also mean creating something like a universal basic income, which would counteract the insecurities provided by the gig economy. And now, what I notice in my environment with freelancers is that there's a trend towards mutualism. So a group of freelancers, particularly those in co-working spaces, which are mushrooming all around Europe, are beginning to find alternative ways based on reciprocity to help each other. Mm. So they amass group purchasing powers among themselves so that they can negotiate better healthcare plans, better insurance. I've even seen a group of freelancers which are actually bidding in the procurement process for larger projects that they were able to do if they were alone. So you see, if you're a freelancer, it's very difficult to negotiate an affordable plan, because usually, as an employee, it's the employer that does it for you. But if you are self-employed, you are alone. The example that Anne gave about the Hollywood model is quite interesting. But let's not go to Hollywood. Let's stay in Europe. You know, there are some construction companies at regional level that are actually giving multi-employer plans. So what happens is that if you're a worker, you can move from building site to building site among these clusters of companies and bring along with you your security and benefits. I think that's an example to be followed.
Perfect. Now, before we open the floor for questions, Brhmie, this is the kind of example that you've been talking about, right? This kind of...
Yeah, I mean, I'm totally for portable benefit platforms and thinking about new partnerships and allowing some of these workers to collectively bargain, for instance. I think that the debate has been too focused on the legal classifications, but I actually want to come back to this point on automation, because I think that a question that we need to ask ourselves is, who owns these machines? Because I think that's another frontier that's kind of emerging in the gig economy, when people are talking about collective ownership and moving towards platform co-ops. So we've seen a surge of that sort of activity happening in the US as well. Juno is a really great example, because it's a ride-sharing company that is in direct competition with Lyft and Uber, and has in fact been trying to poach their drivers. But their whole prerogative is that they're a better platform for drivers. And so they do that in various ways. They, for example, have a 24-hour helpline for their drivers, but then they also offer them the benefit or the advantage of earning shares that are tied to how long they work for Juno. And I think that this sort of collective ownership model is something that we need to really consider, especially as we move into this machine age, because it's fewer and fewer companies that are owning these sorts of technologies, and they're not, they're asset light and they're people light, so they don't own very much. Like, Uber doesn't own any of those cars, they don't employ any of those workers. And so there needs to be a way to reclaim some of that share of wealth. And that's why I would also actually push back against basic income, because I think that we need to be demanding more from businesses. I think that we need to be demanding more from the private sector, and it can't just fall to the state to provide all of these things. And so there needs to be more of a balance here.
That is super interesting. I love this point about the sharing economy. You have to have something to share. I believe the technical term for the London property market right now is a hot mess. So it seems very unfair that those who already own an asset, which is a flat in London, can then stick it on Airbnb. You know, that maybe that's not the most open, accessible business model in the world, because you have to have a flat in London as a starting point. Right, do I see any hands going up? Anybody fancy asking any questions? All right, one at the front. There'll be a microphone coming round. So, quick reminder, as we all know, question means question, it doesn't mean statement, and you should tell us who you are and who you represent. Oh, we'll just have a little... Here we are, perfect. Here we are, in the front row here.
Hi, my name is András Larsson. I'm representing my own company, globalvisionsharing.net. 2 days ago, I was in a conference on the 50th anniversary of the International Labour Organization on the future of work. And one wonderful perspective came up. Nicolas stressed the pivotal need of ethical and moral value in education. So my primal question is that, rethink the meaning of work. What kind of work are we seeking of? We have a lot of transitioning from working to working together, transitioning from only the mantra of growth, outer growth, to inner growth, to personal fulfillment. When you see the number of rising figures of burnout, frustration, stress, and the impact it has on social security, So in Bhutan, you have the index of happiness. So this is all perspectives that we, I think, should rethink the new business model for work and also for consumer society, isn't it?
Perfect, great. So work as a fulfilling thing, and it is the value of work. You know, many people enjoy it. Great. Matthias, Marco, all of your freelancers who are working away, do they?
Well, the level of work-life balance is really important. I think I would like to quote actually some research from the Royal Society of Artists that said 84% of self-employed people are actually happier at work, despite the fact that they earn less. And this is significant. Mm-hmm. Although, when you see all this data about the downfall of incomes of the self-employed, you need to put them into perspective, because actually the biggest raise in self-employment has been in part-time self-employment. So that means, of course, that the income is lower. And also you have to consider the fact that self-employment, the income is raising over time, okay? I mean, the largest majority of freelancers in Europe are actually between 41 and 49 years old. So they're actually older than the equivalent sector employees, and there is actually a big proportion of self-employed, highly skilled self-employed people who are above 65, which is important to mention, because as you age, obviously you tend to seek more autonomy and flexibility from your work life. So I do agree that work-life balance and well-being is a good angle to use for self-employment and freelancing.
Perfect. And Anne, I know you're not the officially here with the Commission hat on, but the Commission is a place where people do comment on work-life balance. Is it something that you're looking at in the Policy Centre? Is this part of your...
Well, I think it underpins. There's a lot of work going on everything we're discussing here, because, you know, there'll be a European pillar of social rights. I would say on the policy side, we are now taking account of the fact that there are more and more people who feel insecure, you know, some of them being pushed into these kind of jobs, but also understanding that there are underlying trends, precisely because of what the gentleman just said. There's another group that wants to work in a completely different way. They don't want 9-to-5 jobs, and that also on the policy-making side, we have to accept. And not, I would argue, not only accept, but embrace, because we always, everything we do is about jobs. Have you ever thought of who creates these jobs? It's precisely the people who first employ themselves. And once you make a living for yourself and it's going well, then you might consider starting a company and hiring others. But the first step will always be that you do this for yourself. And I think we have never looked at the large and growing pool of freelancers as precisely the people who have the potential and whom we need to give an incentive to hire that very first person. Because as I know from own experience, once you hire the first person, it's very likely you're going to continue hiring other people. So, you know, we need to think a little bit more about all of these issues, because no one starts a company with 100 employees. You just don't do that, you know? So we need to take these people more seriously, I would argue, because if you can make it on your own, chances are you can create jobs for others.
Brilliant. Matthias, is this something as a labor market expert?
I liked as well this notion of the gentleman speaking about the value behind our jobs. I mean, it's not only that everyone shall bring his talents to the society and to the markets, but as well in self-employment, you have a quite direct link between offer and demand. So you serve someone who enjoys it and he pays a price, and this makes sense to what you are doing. And from my point of view, this is the best prevention to burnout. Yeah. And when we have a look not at the scarcity of self-employment, but having a look in our big corporates and all these reports saying half of the people don't know what they are doing there, but even they go there because they get their income and they get a security, perhaps this could be as well an information to pick up and thinking about how can we in a way help them to think about becoming self-employed or doing something different, but not within this corporate, but outside, and pave the way for more transitions between these two spheres or worlds. And I think that this will in the end lead as well to a better mixture on overall distribution of the risks in that we now see in a globalized world, not only insiders, outsiders, but as well to spread it over the whole population and via this reduce the risks on the personal shoulder of everyone.
Right, exactly, because it's a very all or nothing model. It's just Brhmie's hard levers, it's all at one end or the other. Brhmie, do you want to come back on any of this? Or? Okay, perfect.
Francis, I want to really maybe go into this notion of security. Because I want to say, I mean, when I was self-employed and I had two children, in many traditional jobs, that means the end of your career as a woman. I think we need to be crystal clear here. But because I was self-employed, I wasn't dependent on anyone else for my career. And I've actually been most successful after I've had children. How many women in the traditional 9-to-5 world can say that about themselves? Very, very few. So my security always came from the fact that I felt like, you know, I am not dependent on others for promoting me and for giving me a chance, because I created opportunities myself. So I wouldn't underestimate sort of the empowering factor of being essentially in charge of your own career.
I have always loved all the jobs I have had. So I would like to, of course, give this opportunity to everyone, that everyone would like to, or should have a job that they really enjoy. But of course, it's not possible, as we know. But I think, again, it's important that we give all the people, we give good basic skills for them. And then after that, they can re-educate themselves. And then maybe they are able to make also choices in their lives. Because now we know that there's many people who can't make this choice.
Great. I see we have another question. So if you want to pop back. Sir, tell us who you are and a brief question.
Yes, just one brief question and following up on what you've been describing so far. And I would like also to quote Henna, Virkkunen, MEP, she has described something that the World Economic Forum has so far presented as the five fundamental skills. I see a divergence there between what we would consider as a concept of labor capital, that is the routine skills that have been employed before, and the value of labor as independent of capital. So wouldn't it be due a rethinking of how taxation has been imposed and created by the states, that actually creates this divergence, because we see that those that are permanently employed get social benefits paid both by themselves, social contributions by themselves and by businesses, and as such benefit from higher benefits, whereas those that are freelancers end up paying all out of their own pockets. So how would you see this new taxation system emerging? Thank you.
Great. Brhmie.
So this is really interesting. I'm not sure how taxation works in most countries in Europe, but in the UK, we're specifically looking at the gig economy because of this issue. So the way that it works is that freelancers or self-employed people pay less than an equivalent employee, but also the businesses who employ workers have to pay something called national insurance contributions, and that is like a significant amount of money. So if we're moving towards this trend of self-employment, it's actually eroding our tax base. And so we're going to have to look at how we completely reconfigure this system so that it is fair and that we do address this point, which is that the state does need to intervene in some way. It does need to be able to fulfill its duties to ensure that people who are unemployed, for example, have benefits at that time. And so if our tax base is eroding because of this trend, then we need to be able to do something about that.
Great. I actually think that the digital economy presents exciting opportunities for shoring up the tax base, because in the digital economy, everything is paid by a credit card. I mean, or a lot of transactions are, there will be a digital record of everything that goes on, because it essentially sort of diminishes the cash economy. And I think this has been underappreciated, what an opportunity this will be for tax collection, which continues to be very important, because if you want to have very comprehensive welfare states, the money needs to come from somewhere. Mm-hmm. And for instance, I just learned there's an interesting scheme where Uber works with the government of Estonia, and where essentially they give all of the records to the government to make sure that these Uber drivers actually pay the taxes, right? Whereas a lot of the traditional taxi business is a cash business. So
in fact, they have real-time taxation system now. Always when you are paying Uber, it's going right away to taxation, you know, taxes.
And
taking.
This is possible for anything else,
for
Airbnb,
for
all of the platforms.
Real-time economy.
This is underappreciated, what a potential this would be to fight tax evasion, because there is a digital record of absolutely everything that goes on.
Airbnb is actually collecting the city council tax in the city of Amsterdam and directly remits them to the municipality as a sort of agreement. But I think the current legal differentiation between employees and self-employed in the member states has actually the unintended side effects of preventing the digital platforms to offer more support to their workers, such as additional insurance or training, because that's if they give that support, actually, it would turn the relationship into an employment one. So attaching liability and a host of legal requirements to conform with. Now, one of the suggestions is to create safe harbors. It just came to my mind when I heard about taxes, because it's a concept very similar to the free tax zones, etc. The safe harbor are actually areas where companies and digital platforms and local policymakers would co-create a sort of innovation zone as a sort of laboratories where the digital platforms can experiment with new forms of work without the fear of liabilities, and they need to reclassify their independent workforce as employee, and then you can use big data to monitor trends. Now, if some of you is familiar with the EU cluster policies, or in France it's called le pôle de la compétitivité, I mean, that would create exactly the right framework to make this happen, and it's been used very successfully on tax-free zones around Europe.
It's perfect. I can picture it now. The freelancers in their trendy co-working space banding together to have their add-on social insurance on top of what they got in a pool de compétitivité. Right. We have 10 minutes left and I've got two questions behind me. So I propose that very, very quickly, I'm relying on you to make these very brief questions, and we'll pop that into a last round of questions. So, sir, here.
Thank you. My name is Pierre Dybman. I had a long career as an independent consultant and a not so short career with the European institutions, which are still socially quite generous, so I've seen both sides. My question is about the gig economy. Is there any statistical evidence that it is providing real added value over the long term? Because I understand that it does provide short-term additional income flow to people, but at the same time, it destroys a lot of capital stock. As we've seen, Amazon has destroyed the libraries, Uber is destroying the taxis in regulated countries where taxi drivers have to buy a license. The hotels, we're in a hotel. Airbnb is destroying the investment in hotels. What's next? The pharmacies will go down the drain with the possibility to buy drugs online. So is there really any statistical evidence that over 10 or 20 years, this is just a redistribution, it's not really creating growth?
Okay, perfect. And very briefly as well.
Thank you very much. My name is Mohammed Rajai Barakat. I wanted to say the same thing like Mr. Watt said here. What's the objective of encouraging self-employment? Isn't it to reduce the responsibility of public sector, of the states? Isn't it so as to go into the direction of the privatization of our society? It's not easy now to be a self-employee. You have the national legislations who are very strict concerning this. And even our governments in European Union, they don't have a strategy for jobs, even for official jobs. When I see in Belgium, for medical sector, they reduce the number of students at universities, and so as to limit the access to these jobs. medical sector, and 10 years after, they come and they say we have to bring thousands of employees from abroad. Well, it's not, yeah?
Yeah, it's great.
thank you, I will stop here. Stability is very important for anyone. When you are self-employed and your age is 65 years old, and you don't have enough money so as to protect yourself for the end of your life, I think many people are thinking about it. And last point, you spoke about robotics.
Very quickly, yeah.
When I came here in radio, they spoke about supermarkets. With self robotics, they are going to reduce 50% of employment. For young people who don't have diplomas from universities, what they are going to do? They are going to chômage. Thank you very much.
Perfect. So now we've got 7 minutes to counteract the fact that this new sector is simply stripping value out of other ones and that it's de-skilling everybody and basically ruining everything. Who wants to go first? Anne.
Okay. I want to be very clear. I'm not a proponent here of the gig economy. However, I think it is precisely sort of the attitudes, what's this all good for, and just keep everything as it is, that will bring about negative change faster. So we have underlying trends, and Europe can't just sort of withdraw from global realities. So I'm of the opinion that we need to take account of what is, for instance, you cannot force people not to shop on Amazon and go in a bookshop instead. I mean, you just can't do that. So, if preferences change, the world changes, it's like defying gravity. It is better using the system to try to see where are really the fallouts and where do we need to intervene. But not how do we stop change. It is simply not realistic. In conclusion, I also want to say, because there's always this tendency to talk about education, when I think the real debate needs to be around skills, because education is one thing, but really following where the skills need is what is needed in Europe, because Andreas Schleicher, who is the author of the PISA study, he spoke to us recently, and he said Europe is overeducated and underskilled. And this is why we have, the double whammy of a very high unemployment and a massive skills gap. We need to close this. We need to really understand where skills are going. So please, rather than education, let's talk about skills, because we wouldn't be living in a better world if everyone had a PhD, because we need people who have different kinds of skill sets. And let me also say, because there is so much anxiety, I think we must also focus on sectors that have the potential to employ lower skilled, because we have lots of them in Europe. So, yes, we must go, towards the upper end, but we must not forget of the lower end. And there are sectors that can accommodate that, and they need to be bolstered. So the point, the bottom line is embrace change, because, there really is no alternative to it. We have underlying trends that are changing the economy in profound ways.
Great.
Yeah, I have to say that I have a very positive attitude towards digital economy, and I think it's good thing for the whole world. And I think it's also very natural if we look to history, always there has came new technologies, and I think it's how the world goes. And I think that it's important that Europe is part of this new digital economy, and I think that we are not prepared for that good enough. If we look how many member states or cities or regions are reacting to new innovations, they are often trying to protect their current jobs and structures instead of encouraging the new innovations and new services. We can see how many cities has reacted, for example, to Airbnb or to Uber in Europe. And I think we should be much, much more open for new innovations, because we have been making big investments to internet. And now, because of internet, all these new services are possible, and our consumers, they just love these services. So, of course, we should encourage now everyone to use internet and digital world opportunities. But I think now we have still some problems with attitude in Europe. We are not open enough. We have often too much regulation. We should have that kind of regulation that encourages new innovations and ideas. And then the other thing is the skills part, because now 90% of the companies in Europe, they are reporting that they have lack of digital skills in their company, 90% already now. And we know that we will need more and more those skills in the future. So I think we have gap also in the skills side.
Great. I'm going to ask the other speakers to come back very quickly on the questions, and I'm going to forbid any of you from talking about education and skills, because that's what the next panel's about, and you mustn't steal all their material. Great. So Airbnb, are they ruining everything? Sorry.
Actually, I just wanted to address this point of distribution and whether or not it's eating into current profits of incumbents. And I think that so Clay Christensen has this theory of disruptive innovation, and within that he actually talks about how right now these companies are probably driving up overall demand, so the types of people that would use Uber or Airbnb normally wouldn't have necessarily gone to a hotel or traveled in that particular way or used a cab, but now this is kind of opening the market up further and it's allowing more people to enter. And I think that we might get to this point where they are eating into one another's profits. And I think at that point, that's when we have to to address market power. So with something like Amazon, I mean, we've seen the EU is now trying to take Amazon to task, and it's a really difficult challenge. But I think that antitrust legislation in general in all countries needs to be updated, and we need to be able to address that issue. But for now, I don't think that we're necessarily eating into each other's profits. I think that it is just about driving up overall demand.
Right, exactly. To use the cliche, it's a bigger cake. Marco, Matthias, you can have literally 30 seconds each for any concluding thoughts.
This is enough.
Perfect.
I would underline what the topic of level playing field. I mean, this is the thing I would say we speak about. Is it really a fair competition between Amazon supermarket and the supermarkets we know, between Uber and the taxi drivers or not? This is the question. And we should as well underline that in our known industries and business models, not everything is perfect, and often there are vested interests within, and these guys show up where are vested interests or not. This is from a political, from an economical point of view, this is helpful. From a political point of view, there will be a transition period which will be highly dangerous, because it directly helps populism to get in and take all the examples you had in your minds, and we have to see how we work this out.
Great. Oh, I'm really sorry. We have to finish now.
I think the, from what I heard from the questions from the audience, I think people are making a very unfair comparison between new forms of work and full-time employment. I mean, full-time employment at scale has been around for decades, and we have had plenty of time to understand the huge imbalances between the individual and the institutions and corrected in a wide variety of ways. So my last message is give the gig economy a chance and don't try necessarily to regulate it, because the moment you regulate it, it's already out of it's already outdated.
Perfect. All right.
I had a point about skills, but I'll leave it for the next panel. I will ask it. I will ask it from the audience.
Wonderful. On that note, this next panel begins at 10:30 sharply. So go out, enjoy your coffee. I'll see you all back here then. And a huge thank you to our panelists and our questioners.